Next topic in breathing and exchange of gases is the respiratory volumes and respiratory capacities. So a person generally breathes around 12 to 16 times per minute. Now in this particular topic, that is respiratory volumes and respiratory capacities, we have different types of volumes, four different types, and five different types of capacities are being measured. So all this measuring is being done by that of a device which is called as a spirometer, or it is even called as respirometer. So what is a respiratory volume and what is the respiratory capacity? So that we'll discuss now. So in case of the respiratory volumes, the first one is called as a tidal volume. Tidal volume is the volume of the air a person can inspire or expire during a normal respiration. So that is called as tidal volume. And it is being calculated that around 500 ml of the air a person can inspire or expire during a normal respiration process. For example, whenever we are sitting idle, okay, so at that time the process of respiration occurs continuously, which means we are unknowingly we are inhaling the air and the air is being exhaled. So that volume of the air, okay, which comes out or which goes out during, which comes in or which goes out during the normal respiration is the tidal volume, which is around 500 ml. So as I said, a normal healthy individual respires at normal or resting condition around 12 to 16 times he will breathe. So if we calculate that 12 into 5, so that we get around 6000 ml, and 16 into 500 ml, that is around 8000 ml, which means a healthy individual during the resting condition, okay, so his tidal volume will be around 6000 to 8000 ml per minute. So next is, after tidal volume, is inspiratory reserve volume. So inspiratory reserve volume refers to the volume of the air, the additional volume of the air a person can inspire, okay, during forcible inspiration. That is inspiratory reserve volume. So this inspiratory reserve volume is around 2000 to 3000 ml, which means whenever we breathe excess, additional, so that additional air which enters into the lungs, so that will be around 2000 to 3000 ml. Thereafter is the next one, that is called as expiratory reserve volume. The additional volume of air a person can expire or exhale, okay, so that is after a forcible expiration, so that is said to be expiratory reserve volume. So that is around 1000 to 1100 ml. So when we try to exhale forcibly, okay, so that additional volume which comes out, so that is 1000 to 1100 ml. And last volume which is being present, so that is called as residual volume. The volume of the air which is being present in the lungs, okay, after the forcible expiration, that is residual volume, which means whenever we try out breathing excess of the air from our lungs, we will not die, because there is certain volume of the air which is being still present in the lungs, okay. So that amount of or volume of the air which retains in the lungs even after forcible expiration, so that is called as residual volume, which is around 1100 to 1200 ml of the air remains in the lungs. Okay, so this is all about the respiratory volumes, and the addition of the respiratory volumes, we get them as respiratory capacities. Now, in case of the respiratory capacities, we have five different types. The first one is inspiratory capacity, expiratory capacity, functional residual capacity, vital capacity, and total lung capacity. So in case of the inspiratory capacity, as I said, respiratory capacities are those when we add up, okay, when we add up the respiratory volumes, we get a capacity. So for example, inspiratory capacity is The total volume of the air a person inhales or inspires after a normal expiration is inspiratory capacity, which means we can add up the tidal volume with that of the inspiratory reserve volume. So that is what we call inspiratory capacity. So TV, that is tidal volume, is a 500, and IRV, inspiratory reserve volume, is a 2500 to 3000. So when we add up 2500 plus 500, it is 3000, and 3000 plus 500 is 3500. So this is the total volume of the air a person can inspire, okay, or inhale after a normal expiration. So that is 3000 to 3500 ml. Next is expiratory capacity. The total volume of air a person can expire after a normal inspiration, so that is called as expiratory capacity, which is the addition of tidal volume plus expiratory reserve volume. So tidal volume is 500 ml, ERV is 1000 to 1100, so that is around 1500 to 1600 ml. Next after is functional residual capacity. The volume of the air, okay, which remains in the lung after a normal expiration. Volume of the air which remains in the lungs after normal respiration, sorry, expiration, is called a functional residual capacity. Remember, residual volume and functional residual capacity. Okay, here the volume of the air retains in the lungs after forced expiration. Volume of the air which retains in the lung after normal expiration. So that is functional residual capacity. So it can be calculated by ERV plus RV. So ERV is 1000 to 1100, plus residual volume is 1100 to 1200 ml. So which gives around 2100 to 2300 ml of the air remains in the lung after normal expiration. Normal expiration 2100 to 2300. Forcible expiration when we do, as I said, there is volume of the air remains. So that volume of the air is 1100 to 1200. So that is the difference between these two. Next is vital capacity. Vital capacity means maximum volume of air a person can breathe in after a forced expiration. Maximum volume of air a person can breathe in after forced expiration, or maximum volume of air a person can breathe out after forced inspiration. So that is called as vital capacity. So VC, so this is IC, this is EC, this next is FRC, now it is VC. Vital capacity is ERV plus TV plus IRV. So total is 4000 to 4600. And the last one is a total lung capacity, means the total volume of the air which is being accommodated in the lungs after a forcible inspiration. So that is called as total lung capacity, which means how much amount of the air can be accommodated in the lungs totally. So that is total lung capacity. So it can be calculated as VC plus RV. Okay, so that is 5100 to 5800. So here you can also add up like ERV plus TV plus IRV plus RV, all put together is the total lung capacity. Now particularly in this topic, breathing and exchange of gases, this particular part is very, very important, because here we can frame four different types of the questions. For example, the first one is based on the definition. For example, a question can be asked like volume of the air which is being present in the lungs after a normal expiration is. So four options: like inspiratory, reserve volume, residual volume, functional residual capacity, total lung capacity. So there the option will be functional residual capacity, because as I said, after a normal expiration, so whatever the volume of the air remains, so that is FRC. Is that clear? So that is one by definitions. Second one is by their volumes. Volumes will be given, and either they may give the volume like tidal volume is. So how much it is? So volumes will be given based on the volumes can ask. Thereafter mass of following. On one side they may give the capacities or volumes, and on the other side they may give the volumes. So matching can be done. So thereafter the third part is based on these equations also. For example, vital capacity is, they may give ERV plus RV, VC plus RV, TV plus ERV, or ERV plus TV plus IRV. So you need to identify. And the last one is based on the graph also, the question can be asked, where the graphs can be given based on the pulmonary volumes or respiratory volumes and respiratory capacity. So we can frame different types of questions based on the respiratory volumes as well as capacities. So you need to focus more on this particular part. Next is after is exchange of gas. Exchange of the gases. So in case of the human body, there are two sites where the exchange of gases occurs. The primary is the alveoli region, where the atmospheric air, when it enters into the lungs, it reaches to that of alveoli, and from the alveoli the oxygen enters into the blood, and from the blood, deoxygenated blood, the carbon dioxide enters into the alveoli. So there the first exchange of the gases takes place. Henceforth, alveoli are said to be the primary site for the exchange of the gases. Second site is when this blood reaches to that of the tissue. From the oxygenated blood, the oxygen is being diffused into the tissues, and meanwhile the carbon dioxide from the tissues is being diffused into the blood. So that is the secondary site for exchange of gases. So how these exchange of the gases occurs? What are those factors which help in the exchange of the gases? What are those factors which are being affecting the rate of the respiration? So among them, the first one is called as partial pressure, next one is the concentration gradient, next is the solubility of gases, and the last one is the thickness of the membrane. Among the four, the two are very important. That is, one is partial pressure, the other one is thickness of the membrane. So here, partial pressure means the pressure of an individual gas, okay, which is being exerted in a mixture of gases. So that is what we call partial pressure. So that is being denoted, that is the partial pressure of the oxygen is being denoted as PO2, and partial pressure of carbon dioxide is denoted as PCO2. Okay, exerted by an individual gas in a mixture of gases. So since childhood we might have thought that we are breathing, but how it is that we only receive or only the oxygen enters into our body and neither nor or any other gases will enter into our body? Why it is only that oxygen enters maximal into our body? That is because one of the reason is a partial pressure. Now if you look after this particular table, which is very, very important for NEET again, so here in the first we have respiratory gas, thereafter is atmospheric air, alveoli, deoxygenated blood, oxygenated blood, and lastly is the tissues. So here whatever the pressures are being measured, so they are being measured in mmHg. Okay, so that is, for example, if you see the partial pressure of the oxygen in the atmospheric air is 159 mmHg, in alveoli it is 104, in deoxygenated blood it is 40, in oxygenated blood it is 95, and in the tissues it is 40. Why? Partial pressure of the carbon dioxide in the atmospheric air is extremely low or less. That is, it is only around 0.3. Thereafter, in the alveoli, it is 40. In deoxygenated blood, it is highest, that is 45. In oxygenated, it is 40. And in tissues also, it is 45. So, which means the partial pressure of the oxygen is comparatively more to that of carbon dioxide, which means this is the gas which enters into your body, which reaches to your tissue because it is having high partial pressure. Meanwhile, whatever the carbon dioxide is being formed in the tissues, that has a high partial pressure. So that comes out of the body through that of the lungs. Okay, so that happens. That is what we call exchange of gases. So here again, as I said, a question can be asked where, for example, they may ask the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide in the atmospheric air is, okay, or they may give here as A, next is B, and thereafter is C. So they may ask identify A, B, and C. So based on the options, you need to identify. So this is the first part, that is partial pressure. Second part is the solubility of gases. Compared to that of oxygen, carbon dioxide has a high solubility of the gas, where it is around 20 to 25% higher than compared to that of oxygen. Henceforth, this carbon dioxide which is being released from the tissues, as it has high solubility, it readily enters into that of the blood. From there, it is being carried to that of the lungs, and from the lungs, it is being transported out. So that is solubility of the gases, which means solubility of carbon dioxide is higher than oxygen. Partial pressure of oxygen is higher than carbon dioxide. So these are simple points you need to focus on. Next is thickness of membranes. So for the exchange of the gases in the alveoli, okay, which are the primary sites, so these are mainly the three membranes which are being involved in the exchange or the diffusion of the gases, where we have alveolar membrane, basement membrane, and capillary membrane. For example, if you focus, this is the alveoli, and this alveoli consists of the membrane which is called as alveolar membrane, as it is being surrounded by that of the blood vessel. So that comes in the next part, that is endothelium of the alveoli or blood vessel, you can call. Next is below that of the alveoli, there is a presence of a small space or the membrane, so that is called as a basement membrane, and below that is the blood vessel, so that is a capillary basically. So this capillary consists of a capillary membrane, and in the capillary membrane we have the RBCs which are receiving the oxygen which is being diffused from the alveoli. So as I said, when the air is entering into the alveoli, that is basically the oxygen which is entering, so that is having partial pressure which is high, that is 104 mmHg. So that air, first it has to pass through the alveolar membrane, thereafter the endothelium, later it has to enter into the basement membrane. Passing through the basement membrane, it has to enter into the endothelium, thereafter is a capillary membrane, and finally it gets diffused into the RBC. That is about oxygen. Meanwhile, the carbon dioxide, initially it has to pass out through that of the RBC, enters into the capillary membrane, endothelium of capillary, thereafter basement membrane, alveolar membrane, and finally it will reach into the alveoli. Is that clear? So here you have to focus on that in between the alveoli and the capillary, there is a presence of a membrane which we generally call it as basement membrane. As the basement membrane is involved in the exchange of the gases, this basement membrane is also called as respiratory membrane. Very important part here is the thickness of these three membranes. Thickness of membrane is inversely proportional to the diffusion of the gases. Remember, very very important, where a question can be asked in the assertion reasoning, or it may be statement wise. Okay, what I said is thickness of the membrane is inversely proportional to diffusion of the gases, which means if a thickness of membrane is more, okay, then diffusion of the gases will be low. If thickness of the membrane is less, then diffusion of the gases will be high. So that is what I said, inversely proportional. So on a whole, in general, if you consider the membranes, alveolar, basement, and capillary membrane, all the three membrane has a very little thickness, that is less than 1 mm, which means it is around 0.3 mm. So this is the thickness of the three membranes together. So it is very negligible. So henceforth, as the thickness of the membrane is less or least, the diffusion of the gases will be higher. So there is, we will not have a problem in the process of respiration, as because the membrane thickness is very low or less. So this is very, very important factor which affects the respiration and partial pressure, solubility of the gases, and concentration gradient. So regarding concentration gradient, okay, for example, we have a condition where in case of the sea divers, whenever a person, a sea diver without carrying an oxygen cylinder, if he dives into a deep water, so there he may have a problem, he may suffocate, where he may not get sufficient amount of the oxygen. At that time, what happens? The carbon monoxide which is being present, that starts splitting, where the oxygen O is being released and carbon monoxide starts accumulating in the lungs. So the carbon monoxide content, okay, starts increasing when compared to that of oxygen. Means the concentration gradient of the carbon monoxide is higher than that of the oxygen, due to which the hemoglobin, which is there basically, so that is having higher affinity when compared to that of the oxygen, which means 200 times more affinity is being present, that the hemoglobin will bind with the carbon monoxide than oxygen. Henceforth, when the lungs keep on accumulating, when in the lungs, when the carbon monoxide keeps on accumulating, so that individual dies due to that of this accumulation of carbon monoxide. So that is what we call as carbon monoxide poisoning. So that is concentration gradient. Is that clear? So this is all about respiratory volumes and capacities and exchange of the gases.